for the questions for now.
Okay, thank you very much for your questions. Then I continue with the second part. The journey through a mentee, and we continue with that. And we will go through a number of plates which show more tests and trials. We will show pictures dealing with the so-called seven gates, the 10 pylons and the 10 spheres. We will deal with the so-called opening of the mouth procedure. And we will start before the next break already with a description of the great renunciation. That's the next and the sixth initiation before we continue with that in the third part. So first, more tests and trials. We go to plate number 10. And we go directly to the left-hand side detail. And what we see here is a male cat symbolizing the god Ra that beheads the snake Apepe, or Apophis, as it is called. Apepe is the symbol in mythology for the enemies of Ra. It is a huge snake that took its place every morning in the darkest part of the sky and waited there until sunset approached and then devoured the sun. But Ra then enchanted the serpent, rendering it powerless. Symbolically, it are the enemies of Ra. And these are not the external enemies or anything physical, but all the traits of that people can detect in their own lower psychic nature. We can read in the text, the rising sun overcomes the darkness. The greatest enemies that every man, and especially every initiate, can encounter are the serpents or snakes of evil that every man has formed in his own thinking, attachments, desires and emotions linked to the outer world, such as, for instance, prejudice and the tendency constantly to judge others, projecting your own thinking onto the world and seeing and considering that as the truth. And you probably know yourself many more examples in this sense. When we look at this detail at the right-hand side, we see three guardians with butcher knives. These triangle things are butcher knives. And Ani recognizes the three guardians and says, "Free me from the guardians with the butcher knives, who have terrible fingers and who defeat the followers of Osiris." And these followers of Osiris are people trying to rise above the illusion of the material world. And in doing so, they appeal to their higher nature in such a way that their lower nature opposes this. And the elements of the lower nature are thus presented here as the guardians with the butcher's knives. And you can compare this also with the story in Buddhism about the enlightenment of the Buddha and the battle with Mara, for instance. Or in the Bible, in the New Testament, you find Jesus and John with their temptation in the desert. We go to a next detail of this plate, and we see Ani in front of the solar boat with in it Ra as the scarab or the god Kepira. And we see also the gods of the dawn, the monkeys with the dog's head. And on the boat we see again the feather symbol of the millions of years of eternity. And as we said earlier, the scarab is the symbol of eternal life. And it is also the symbol of re-embodiment. Now, we see another plate. We see an image of the setting sun, the big red circle, with Ani in the solar boat as the god Tem. The text states that Ani has taken possession of the realm of Amenti and that he is strong. And Ani warns the lion, the god Rehu, here at the right-hand side of the plate, to turn right around. We go to the next plate, 11 plus 12, which is about, to show something about sub-areas of Amenti, where he always has to show and to prove, and that is again a test, that his higher nature is continuously in charge. We see that in this plate, two plates put together, showing the so-called seven gates and 10 pylons. Because the Egyptians assumed that the underworld, the domain of Osiris, was divided into districts which all had a kind of castle. And during this journey, Ani has to pass seven gates and 10 so-called pylons. The seven gates at the top have guardians, of which he must know the names and the corresponding spell of the gate. And below we have 10 pylons, of which he must know the name of the guardian, of the guardian god. Let's first have a look at the gates at the top level. And we will only mention a few examples. At gate 1, Ani mentions the names of the gods and says, "I am the mighty one who created his own light." And that means that he himself worked to broaden his consciousness and to ennoble himself. Then Ani says, "I have come to you, O Osiris, and purified from that which defiled you, I revere you." And gate 2, Ani should recognize one of the guardians through the following characterization: "He who follows the desires of his heart and weighs the words like a helper of thought." Ani goes to gate 3 and he says, "I have come and I have done away the offensive thing which was upon Osiris." It means, "I have purified myself, enlightened myself, and brought spiritual impulses into the world." He goes to gate 4 and he says, "I am the son of Osiris. I have accomplished the journey. I have advanced in Amenti." He goes to gate 5 and says, among other things, "I have brought together the body parts of Osiris. I have poured water on the wounds." And as you may know, the body of Osiris was divided by his brother Set into 14 parts. And that Horus brought those parts back together, and Isis made them again into a living Osiris. And it is clear that these parts of the body are only symbols. For also the initiate had to join the parts of his own nature. His seven principles, which have a part which is focused on the material life and a part which is focused on the spiritual life. So altogether, 7 times 2, 14 parts. And he has to join that into one whole, into a complete man. It means that man, tossed around between the lower and higher aspects of his thinking, has to make a clean sweep. He has to ensure that all aspects of his consciousness form an harmonious whole, a unit. His higher faculties are leading in this. The awareness of oneness of life, the awareness of the interconnectedness of life, and the awareness that thinking is the ability with which he can consciously focus on the higher, compassionate side of his nature. The lower faculties are instruments that are used as a means, as a vehicle. At gate 6, Ani says, "I am the avenger according to law. I have avenged the injury of his eyes, that is the eye of Horus. I have defended Osiris. I have accomplished my journey." Finally, he goes to gate 7 and says, "I have come to you, O Osiris, being purified from foul emissions." Then Ani goes to the 10 pylons. He has to recognize and name the beings at the different pylons. Here the Book of the Dead lacks, in fact, the necessary information to properly give significant interpretations of the Egyptian psychology. But I give 3 examples. At pylon 1, he has to give the name of the god at that pylon. He calls it the Lady of Terror. At pylon 2, he mentions the Lady of Heaven. Pylon 7 is an interesting one because it is also understandable. Ani says, "The garment which envelopes the helpless one, which weeps for and loves that which is covered." A little bit of a complicated sentence. But if you think this sentence over, so I read it again. "The garment which envelopes the helpless one, which weeps for and loves that which is covered." And this text contains a warning. You must be strong and detached to go through the processes of initiation. So now we move on in Amenti and go to the next phase. Ani comes to 2 gates that lead him into another world, behind which are the 10 spheres symbolized by 42 gods. And it looks like this plate. It are 10 vertical columns symbolized by gods. And the whole plate shows us 2 gates through which Ani is led by the Sem priest. Then there are 10 realms which consist of different gods. Different gods in which you always discover the same figures like Osiris, Isis and Horus. And they represent 10 realms of being. For example, the realms of nature. Ani needs to recognize those 10 different realms. After Ani has recognized the 10 realms and gods, Ani says, "Hail Thoth, who made the word of Ani true against his enemies." make sure that Osiris Ani can make the word true against his enemies. And then comes the phase in which the coming teachership presents itself to Ani, a really mystical phase. And we see that in the coming plate, 15, we see here a plate with various smaller plates. The total image is about the powers which Ani is going to gain in Amenti. And we go now to the left part with the detailed picture. Ani stands opposite the Sem priest at the right hand side, the one with the leopard skin, and the Sem priest is holding a kind of stick in his right hand, and this stick is called the Urheka, and Urheka means big in words, having a big influence. And the meaning of this is that the initiant is given a voice. His mouth is being opened. And it means that he has become an inspirator and teacher for others. He can influence other sentient beings. Ani gets a voice in Amenti, obtains influence and power. You can find similar texts in other traditions. For instance, you will read in the Bible, in the New Testament, in the Sermon on the Mount, in Matthew 5, verse 2, that Jesus says, that it is said about Jesus, and he opened his mouth and taught them. And you will find that also in Buddhist texts. All this fits exactly with the phase of mystical youth that accompanies the initiation of the great temptation. The next detail of that plate 15, in this you will see Ani opposite Anubis with his heart in his right hand. Anubis is one of the symbols of Mercury, we said before. And between Ani and Anubis is a necklace with colored beads and with a clasp in the shape of a pylon. In the shape you can see a kind of emblem with the solar boat with the scarab on it, the symbol of dawn and reincarnation. Ani says, "Let my heart be with me in the house of heart." And he expresses the wish that he does not lose his heart in the underworld, in Amenti. And that his heart, the core of his being, can manifest in the sphere where it belongs. The next detail of plate 15, we see at the left side, Ani with his soul, his Ba or Ka, that's not clear. Ani says, I am he who comes forth from the celestial water. He, the celestial water, produced abundance for me and had the mastery there in the form of the river Nile. This could mean that the celestial waters are in general considered as a symbol of the astral world, that is usually the case, and that from that world, powerfully, like the Nile, flows the manifestation into the illusory material world of which we are all part. In the middle of this detail, we see Ani with a ship, which is a symbol for breath and air. Ani says, I am the egg which dwelt in the great Kekler. I keep ward over that great place which Cap, the god of the earth, had proclaimed upon earth. The egg is a universal symbol of the essential inner life surrounded by the eggshell. And just as the embryo within the egg gets air and grows, so the spiritual core of Ani grows. So grows his inner light. Then, the right-hand side detail, we see Ani with the staff, the sign of power. He always allows his higher nature, his heart, to prevail. And he has control over his lower, psychic, astral nature and over Amenti. Finally, Ani says, I don't let my heart be taken away from me in Amenti. This is the sign that he has gained control over Amenti. He has gained control over the astral world. Conclusion is that Ani succeeds. He has not let his heart be taken away. His higher nature stayed always in control. And he controls his lower psychic astral nature in Amenti. He has control over his conscience. He has realized in himself Osiris Lunus. And here you would expect actually a following plate that reflects theophany, that means the symbolizing of this face of Osiris, being one with Osiris. However, there is no such plate in the present Book of the Dead immediately after this series of plates, where Ani would appear in before the throne of Osiris. And as I mentioned earlier, according to the Egyptologist Wallace Budge, amongst others, there is a good portion of the Book of the Dead missing. Hence, we would like to state as a hypothesis that in this place, in the Book of the Dead, there is at least one plate missing, but probably more than one, depicting the successful fifth initiation of Theophany. Before the second break, I would like to make a simple start with the subject of the initiation of the Great Renunciation and the relationship with Osiris Horus. Now, what is the initiation of the Great Renunciation? The sixth initiation is the period of mystical adulthood. The individual initiant gives up all hope of individual progress for himself. What does he need to develop? He needs to develop the control of the pure use of all aspects of his thinking. He needs to fully develop understanding and intuition. His only goal is to become a savior for his fellow man. And this initiation takes place around the summer solstice, around June 21st, the longest day. This is the period of the Midsummer Festival. The duration of the initiation is 14 days. And he descends again in the underworld during this initiation. He's going again to higher spheres than our sphere. He's going to the heart of the sun. The initiant meets another than his own higher self. And this is called theonosti, divine inspiration. He becomes consciously united with his inner God. The inner God of the initiate breathes in him for a shorter or longer period of time, according to the level of development of the initiate. The result after the initiation is that he accomplishes the condition of theonosti, and in rare cases this lasts as long as the remaining lifetime of the initiate on earth. After this initiation, the place and duty in the world of man is assigned to him as a member of the order of wisdom and compassion. He will have become a bodhisattva, he whose essence is wisdom. What is the initiation of the great renunciation in relation to the Book of the Dead? To start with some background information on the term Osiris Horus. In the cosmogony of Egypt, we recognize the same triad as in all other cosmogonies in the world. For instance, the Indian cosmogony mentions Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva. In ancient Egypt, it was Osiris, Isis and Horus. In Christianity, we find Father, Holy Spirit and Son. Now, what was the meaning of the triad at the level of the cosmos and at the terrestrial level? We see that in ancient Egyptian mythology, we find the idea of, at the cosmic triad level, of the older Osiris, Isis and Horus. And when you study stories which are talking about the terrestrial triad, we find that they are mentioned the younger Osiris, Isis and Horus. Let's have a look what the meaning of all this is. First, let's have a look at the cosmic triad. And please remember that all ancient gods, in whatever country, were considered dual, a male aspect and a female aspect, so that, for instance, there was a divine father and a divine mother of the universe. First, the cosmic triad. Osiris symbolized the cosmic intelligence, the ideas of the cosmos. And Isis symbolized the spirit of love and compassion manifesting in the cosmos. Horus, their son, the demiurge, the so-called creator and innovator through the process of emanation. That was the cosmic triad. Now let's have a look at the terrestrial triad symbolized by the younger Osiris, Isis and Horus. The terrestrial triad is a reflection of the cosmic triad. These were the younger Osiris and Isis, who were considered in ancient Egyptian theology to relate to our earth. Osiris was one of the seven solar logoi or solar forces emanating from the spiritual sun. Isis was the spiritual counterpart of the younger Osiris, that which manifests itself on the earth, and especially in the hearts of men, as sympathy, love, compassion, and the creative power of our minds and hearts. Horus is their son, the product of the best in man, the enlightened thinking. Now, also a word about the symbolism of the use of the words serpent, snakes and dragons, which was used in all cultures and also in Egypt. A sage who pursued compassion and the interest of all beings and had knowledge of all nature was in many countries indicated with snake, naga or dragon. A snake, as we all know, during its development regularly sheds its skin, as it were its body, and then it continues to live again. Therefore, it became the symbol of wisdom and immortality. In Matthew 10, verse 16, Jesus says, "Be wise as serpents and innocent as doves." In some countries, the symbol of the serpent is a dragon. The characteristic of a snake of wisdom, a naga, is that he works from man's free will and has authority and inspires. Then, the serpent or the snake of evil, also called sarpa. There is also this symbolism for beings that seek power in our world through deceit, trickery or insinuation. That is the serpent or snake of evil, designated with sarpa. In ancient Egypt, you also see this one. In stories, you see that initiates of the various cultures have to defeat the serpents or dragons of evil with their various weapons in order to become a serpent of wisdom themselves. All this, of course, symbolizes the victory of the spiritual over the material and the personal through the ennoblement of the thinking. Examples are Krishna, who crushes the seven-headed serpent Kalinaga, Hercules chopping off the heads of Hydra, the water snake, and Ra decapitating the snake Apepe. They are all names for the same thing, the dark side of Osiris. Characteristics of the serpent or snake of evil, Sarpa, are that he works from the subjugation of the free will of man and exercises power and manipulates. We see these thoughts reflected in one of the meanings of the symbol of the famous Caduceus, the staff of Hermes, corresponding with the god Thoth, and around it we see turning in two opposite directions, the serpent of wisdom and the serpent of evil. And in some cases, this refers in our world to the medical world, although we see often the Asclepius from Asclepius referring to the Greek tradition, but we see sometimes in the medical world still the Caduceus as a symbol for the medical world, and it comes from the ancient Egyptian tradition. There is another thing I would like to say something. We see in all the traditions when the initiate succeeds that he comes again into the world through a mystical virgin birth. He is not born again from a father and a mother, but born from his own spiritual nature. He expresses his inner divinity without anything from outside. And we see this in the Egyptian religion. We see that symbolized by Isis wearing the child Horus on her lap, and she is called the Virgin Mother Isis. And later on we see a similar symbol which probably has its roots in ancient Egypt, that of Mary and the infant Jesus. This is all I wanted to tell you in the second part of this lecture. I propose now to have a break of 3 minutes, and we will see you after the break.
Yeah, there are several questions this time.
Right.
And I'll say them to you in the following order as they entered. The first question is, you talked about passing those gates, those seven gates. Is it possible that you are rejected or that you, when you pass one gate, you are sent back later on?
Yeah, well, you should look at all those different tests and trials as a symbol for having developed certain aspects in your consciousness. So you can give the right answer at all these gates and pylons if you have developed in yourself the right aspects in your consciousness. And you can see at the type of answer the initiate has to give that it most of the time relates to ethical aspects. That's the overall impression you get. So it is very subtle whether you have developed in yourself the real finer ethical understanding of how just thinking and acting should be according to your conscience. And if you have not sharp in your consciousness what right and wrong is in any condition, then you may give the wrong knock on the door because you have not the right answer or do not resonate in your consciousness with the right knock on the door of that gate or pylon, and then you fail, and then actually you fail in the initiation.
Well, that sounds very subtle.
Yeah, it does. It does.
Well, the next question, someone panicked a bit. He said, oh, pylons and numbers of doors, I'm totally lost.
Yeah.
What does this now stand for from a theosophical terminology?
Well, you should look at this in this way. We are now talking about the four, in these series of lectures, about the four higher initiations. And they all have a different character. But you should realize that these are the main initiations of the higher grades. But in fact, it gives a grand overview of the different aspects that need to be developed and at the right level, qualitatively, of the initiate to be successful. And that because we know that each principle of man, there are seven principles, is also, again, sevenfold, you can understand that these higher initiations also have sub-phases, so sub-initiations, you could say, that deal with sub-aspects of the main aspects or the main principles of our consciousness. You can imagine that to develop, for instance, Bodhi or the enlightenment principle, that you can imagine that there are different initiations where you have to develop a sub-step of this aspect of Bodhi, and that it takes more than one initiation, such as the sixth initiation, where you have to show that you have developed the sub-aspects of this principle. So there are more initiation than the total group of seven, that's the overview. But it's said that there are 7 times 7 is 49 initiations. So there is different steps also in initiations. And that is probably why in the Egyptian Book of the Dead you see all those many gates, pylons, doors, because they are indications of the divisions of this realm of Amenti, because I mentioned that it is divided into 12 or 14 sections. Mm-hmm. And then in these different sections, you have all those doors and gates and pylons. And that is actually symbolizing that these initiations have different sub-steps, and they are now described in all in one go, but they probably were aspects of subsequent initiations which were taken in one or more than one life.
Thanks. Next question. When the initiation is successful, and he returns to Earth as a bodhisattva, can its influence be experienced by the inhabitants of the Earth?
Yes, certainly. Because I said that his task and function is given in the world as a teacher, and also as part of the guardian wall to protect the Earth from influences from outside the Earth. And his work is to be active in inspiring especially human beings to enlighten them, learn to enlighten themselves and to make a more a better world, in the sense that compassion will be the main policy of every individual. Mm-hmm. So that everybody will become focused on spiritual development of all. So that is the message he was going to teach, which has been the message for eons of all the great teachers and sages in the world. So he will be one of them in line in doing that, taking up his task in the future.
That sounds very hopeful.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. And then the last question.
Last question, yeah.
Can we make a parallel between Osiris and Arjuna, or would Osiris be at the same rank as Krishna?
Well, we can, if we compare the two symbols in both the Book of the Dead and the Bhagavad Gita, then we can say that Osiris is corresponding to Krishna, so the higher self, and Ani, the initiate. In the Book of Ani, he's called Ani, but it's a symbol for every man who is going through the process of initiation. Ani is the man who is getting initiated, and in the Bhagavad Gita, it is Arjuna who is getting initiated or getting inspiration from his higher self, Krishna.
Well, thanks. Those were the questions.
Okay. Thank you for your questions. Then we go...